This week's subject is all about art. My bad art. And I could spend this whole episode talking to you about how I tried to make beautiful planets in pixel art using AssistSprite, or even worse, design of ships. But stay tuned. We're gonna talk about shaders. I'm better at shaders than I'm at art. I'm gonna tell you that. Hey everyone, welcome, I'm Ombarus, and this week we're going to talk about making a grid-like swipe through the screen. If you look at other games that have a tile-based system, you'll see that in their art, there's often something to remind the player of the size of the tiles, and so to make it easy for the player maybe to count how many tiles there is between him and the enemy or something like that. But my problem is I couldn't figure a way to make my background remind the player of the tile. I mean, it's a space background. I could try to arrange the stars in the background in a kind of tile pattern, but I don't think it would look good. So I thought, why wouldn't I make it like you had like some sort of scanner, because you do have a scanner equipped, and then the scanner would from time to time just swipe the screen and then reveal the tiles. And I thought, the best way to do that would probably be with shaders. And then I saw a video this week that showed a feature I didn't even know existed in Godot 3.1, and that's the visual shader. I saw a video of this, and I'm gonna link it in the description below and probably in the corner here. But check it out if you want to see a different thing you can do with this visual shader. But let me show you my take on this visual shading editor. So the first thing I did is I created this green square, and then I put it in a new scene that I created, and then I used that square to make a grid by basically just tiling it as far as I wanted. For example, I just loaded my texture here of my green square, and then to tile it, I just specified the size I wanted, so I don't know, like 2048 by 2048, for example. And so it created this grid here. The next step was pretty simple too. Just create a new material and then use a new shader material. But in my material, instead of creating a regular shader, I created this new visual shader that I hadn't noticed before. With the visual shader here, you can set a couple of parameters. First of all, I don't want a spatial shader. I want a canvas item, which simplifies a little bit things. So now, you see, when you click on the shader here, it's going to pop this visual shader window. And if you enlarge it, you can see that you have the output here, which is all the stuff you can set for the material. And then the first thing I did was actually just try to animate the alpha of my texture. So to do that, you just need to bring in the texture. I just choose my texture, I load it, I choose which parameter from my texture I want. In this case, I want the color. Then I connect the UV with the UV, and I connect the input and the output. I don't care about the LOD because it's always going to be 1-for-1. And then, well, basically I have the same thing I had before, but this time I can animate the alpha on my grid. And to do that is actually fairly simple, because there's only really one thing that can be used to animate inside a shader, and that's the time. And thank God, there's an easy input here that you can use to select time. But of course, time only goes up. So I don't even know what's exactly the value of time, but if you click on the little eye here, you can see a preview of what the value is if you just put it in the color here. And as you can see, it's just purely white. For example, the UVs here show you that from the top here, it would be 0, 0, and then you go red and green, and the bottom right is 1, so 1, 1, which is yellow. So this is really useful. This is something that's really makes the visual shader much easier to use than a normal text-based shader, because at every step of the way, you can see the intermediate result of what you're doing, so you can have a good idea if what you're doing makes sense or not. So in my case, I want to animate the alpha, so I'm just gonna create scalar function, So then I can have a bunch of different functions that you can find easily in most GDScript or stuff like that. But for this case, I'm going to use the sin function so that whatever value my time is, it's always going to be modulated between minus 1 and 1. And then I can put the sin here and replace the alpha with this. And so if you look now, you're going to see that my grid is pulsating. So it's going from minus 1 to plus 1. And if I wanted, I could play around with some numbers and I could make sure that it always goes from 0 to 1. Because right now it's much longer dark than it's light. But that's fine. For now, that's just a proof of concept, right? Because after that, once I figured out a little bit how to use this, I need to figure out exactly what my formula is going to be for the animation I'm planning. So here's a little bit my thought process on this. I'm trying to create some kind of wave going from the left of my texture and moving to the right. And what do I know that can create waves? Well, the only thing I know of is the sin function. And if you know a little bit about your sin function, you're going to know that it's written a little bit like that. Amplitudes times sin of frequency times x plus phase equal the result you're looking for. So, what all of these values mean in the case of my grid? If I want my wave to move from left to right, well, what I'm trying to move is the phase. So my animation time is probably going to be the phase parameter. Okay, what's next? Well, since the coordinates are based on the UV, then it means that the UV is going to be my X. It doesn't matter which one. If I want the wave to go from left to right, I'm going to use the U. If I want the animation to go up and down, I'm going to use the V. And if I want a combination of both, then I just use a combination of the U and the V to create some kind of angle in my animation. So what are the amplitudes and the frequency? Well, that's just parameters that I can use to adjust the speed of the animation and the size of my wave. So it's just uniforms that I'm going to expose in the code so that I can tweak them on the fly. So okay, let's have a look at the final result I came up with after all of this. So if you look at the final shader code, you can see a little bit the formula I was talking about. So you have my X, that's the UV, you have a uniform, that's the frequency, and I multiply those together, and then I have the time as my phase. I had to add another uniform for the phase shift because I didn't want necessarily the wave to move at like X unit per second. I wanted it to maybe move faster or slower. And so the only way to control that is to multiply the time by some constant. Aside from that, you can see that once I have the phase, I add it to the X and the frequency. And then I put all of this in the sin method. Now, what the second part does is a little bit more tricky. So the first part after the sin is just normalizing the function, because normally a sin goes from minus 1 to plus 1, but there's no minus 1 in alpha colors. So I add 1 to be from 0 to 2, and then I divide by 2 so that my function is always going to go between 0 and 1. Now the next tricky part before I multiply the actual alpha of the texture by my result is here. I multiply the actual alpha by the result. The last little part here, that thing is because I didn't want the same amount of black as I have green. So the sin wave normally is exactly the same pattern repeating. So I'm going to be black just as much as I'm green. And I didn't want exactly that. I wanted the green to swoop, but then I didn't want another wave to come right after. I wanted some time in between and I wanted to be able to control that. So what I figured is I could use the amplitude for that. So once I know that my wave is between 0 and 1, I have this amplitude, so which means I'm going to stretch my wave. So it's actually going to be more than 1, and I multiply it, but then I offset again the result by a certain number, so in this case 1. So that means that if I multiply my amplitude by like 10, it means that I'm 90% of the time under 0 and then just a little bit above 0 at the tip of my wave. Of course, when it's negative, it can do some weird effects. So that's why at the end here, I put a max and a min to cap my values, no matter what they were at the end. And the final result is this. You can see here, there's a wave, and then I have a huge section of black, and then another wave will come in a little bit later. And these parameters can be changed at will from the shader parameter. So you see, I can change the frequency. So right now I have a frequency of 0.3, but if I put a frequency of 5, then you can see that I have just these tiny little thing traveling really fast. But I can also change the speed. So if I make it 5 times faster, it's just like some kind of zzz, zzz, zzz. But I can make it also very, very slow. And it's really just a question of which one is preferable or not. And the amplitude will have an effect on how much black I have between each of my line. So if I put it to 1, actually there's nearly nothing. So if I put it to 2, yes. And maybe make it a little bit faster. You see that I don't have much space in between each of my waves. Of course, each of the parameters are not completely independent, so changing one often means that you have to change another one. But I'm fine with that. So if I put this one at 0.5, you know, it's gonna tighten it a little bit. But you can see that the waves comes much faster now. And I can even put it at like, I don't know. But if I put it at 50 or something, then I have one little wave and then a lot of black space in between each. Right? Like only a tiny little wave and then a lot of black and then another tiny little wave and so on. And I think it's a pretty cool effect. And the last thing I could maybe show is that there's a box here that's not connected to anyone, that's the vector decompose, because right now it's just automatically converting the UV into a scalar, like basically a float, by taking, I guess, the average between the U and the V, which creates a diagonal wave. But if I wanted to, instead I could connect it to, for example, only the X component, and so my wave would travel in the X direction like this, for example, something like that. And of course, I could connect it to the V component so that my wave would travel up and down. And I could do some more operations there to have it travel like only left, only right, or something like that. But I decided that diagonal was the coolest I could get it. So like, I don't need to do anything special, but I keep the box just in case I decide to change it eventually. So that's pretty much what I've been doing this week. It's been a lot of art. Actually, I've been studying different look and feel because I want to hire an artist, but I feel I need to figure out exactly what art style I want before I can do that. And I've been playing around with maybe having a more stylized kind of stuff with a lot of heavy pixel art and not many shaders or graphic doodads or stuff like that. And then on the other hand, try to have something more modern. It's still kind of pixel art, but I'm using shaders, I'm using particles, light effects and stuff like that. I really would like to know what you guys think looks the best. Of course, I think the second one looks more modern, more beautiful. But for the kind of game I'm making, which is kind of a roguelike, I feel the more maybe basic look, the more clean look might be appealing for the kind of tactical gameplay. It's, you know, less distracting. So I'm kind of right now leaning toward option one. Let me know, guys, what you think in the comment section below. And also, don't forget to hit that subscribe button and check out my Patreon links at the bottom. Consider supporting me. It really means a lot. Any little amount helps. And see you guys in my next episode. Bye!